Hey everybody, it's Danny, Senior Analytical Training Consultant here at SAS. And what we're going to be talking about today is creating your own SAS custom step inside of SAS Studio. Now, what I'm going to do in this video is actually start giving you an idea of how I think about approaching this. Now, I'm not saying that my way is the best way, but this is how it makes sense to me. So I'm hoping that that is going to be well communicated for you guys as well. Feel free to follow my guide if this makes sense to you too. So you've decided you want to make a SAS custom step for you and your coworkers. What should you do first? Please do not start the design process. That skips a bunch of things that you need to be doing first. So what do you really need to do first? The best thing you can do first is decide on a currently working set of code that you actually want to make into your custom step. Now, I have an example here. Feel free to join with me and I'll walk you through it. Now, in this example, I have a proc kclus procedure. It's going to be performing clustering analysis for me and putting together my observations into smaller clusters. Now, this code currently works. If I ran it right now with all of these data sets and things set, I will have output. I will be able to start using this and doing my analysis. Making sure that you start with working code is the best thing you can do, because now you don't have to focus on making sure the code is right at the same time as you are building all of the intricate pieces that you're wanting to put into your custom step. You can divide and conquer the work. Now, in this example, the first thing that I want to look at is dividing up my code into areas that I call generalizing and expanding. Now, generalizing is aspects of code that if I were to run this in another data set, these are the things that I have to change to make sure that it works for the other data set. Expanding are aspects of the code that aren't required, but are fun little changes that you can make to your actual program to get additional pieces. So we need to decide which way is actually the generalizable part and which part is the expanding part. Now, the most common things that are always the generalizable part is the actual name of the input data set that you're planning on working with, the name of an output data set that you would like to send your information to, and then, of course, the names of the variables that are going to be utilized within the actual analysis. Those are what I would consider your generalizing pieces. Now, there can be more, there can be less, depends on your application. By the way, if you want to know the way to think about the generalizing part, think about macro variables, because that's where we're heading when we actually want to do this in the program part. Think about what would you use a macro variable to represent and put a percent let at the top of the code that would allow you to change things very quickly. That's a great way to decide what's a generalizable piece. But what about the expanding part? Now, the expanding part would be code that would be nice to have every so often. So for example, are we going to want to impute missing values every single time? Probably not. Will we want to have a statistic to determine how many clusters are created, or would we like it to actually be a certain number that we decide? That's a decision that we can make. That's an option that we can take. So these are the different elements of things that we would kind of look into the idea of saying these would be the expandable pieces. Now, what do I do when I decide something is generalizable versus something is expandable? I slightly just put in a little bit of editing to my code. Let me show you what I do. So what you see here in the code that I have got now is everything that is considered to me in a generalizable area are in curly braces. Hence, my input data set, my output data set, my variables. Everything that I declared or suggested could be the expandable pieces are inside of the greater than less than brackets. The imputations, the number of clusters. Now, why is this important? Because this helps you organize yourself to try to decide what actually do I need to get the GUI to do? What aspects of the GUI does the user have to decide upon that's then going to be incorporated into my code? Taking this time clarifies all of that for your problem and takes one big, big concern off of your mind. Now, there's another thing that I want to kind of talk about, and that is, how would you actually then incorporate some of these items into the actual GUI? Well, let me show you this really quick, and this is something that's always important to think about too. So if I go in and try to create a custom step, you're going to see that I'm in the designer really quick. But notice down here in the bottom left, you're going to see a lot of objects. Now, let's think about this. We have definitive objects that will always be used for the input table, your input data set, your column selector, which variables do you want to use, and your output data set, the output table. All of that will be obvious what you would want to probably use for those particular items. But look at the common list. Things like a checkbox, a list, a section, a date time picker, text and text numeric fields. Okay, let's think about this for a second. I'm gonna pull my code back up. Now, these imputations, let's think about this. You're either going to want the imputation to take place or not to take place. So basically, we only have two choices, right? You either want it or you don't. What do you think will be the best item to use, an object to use inside of our GUI? I think a checkbox would be great. Check it if you want it, don't check it if you don't. So I'm going to think my imputation elements are going to be with checkboxes. Okay, well, what about the number of clusters? Do you want to tell me the number of clusters that you want to use? Or do you want a statistic like the ABC statistic to figure it out? Well, that's not a yes-no answer, is it? That's a decision among a few items. Now, this is where it gets interesting, because you have several choices of what you can actually use when you have a selection of things of which you're only choosing one. But I usually look at it in terms of how many options do you have to go through. That helps me figure out what would probably be the better object. So what am I talking about here? We only have two things. Tell me the number, use a statistic. That's a very limited number of choices of which you're picking one. I would say a radio button would be great here. But what if the number of choices of which you're picking one is bigger? Maybe you want to use a drop-down list for that, because then you won't have as many things in the radio button list. Now, what's the mystical, magical number of how many options does it take for you to switch between those two? That's not for me to say. It's just what looks good to you on the GUI. This is your custom step. You make that decision. So now that we've actually got all of this set, this actually completes a lot of work before we even do anything inside of this problem to try to create the custom step. And taking that time is extremely important because, again, doing all of this up front focuses your attention to just those elements right now. And then when you truly start working on the UI and the connection to the code, life gets a lot easier because you're not concerned about missing something. That's always important. So we've got our workable code. We've isolated out what is the generalization, what's the expansion. We've got our ideas of what objects we're going to bring into the GUI. So now it's time to write the GUI. Wait. This video is getting too long. We're going to need to pause here and we'll pick back up in another video. So thanks again for joining us, everybody. Hope that you're enjoying this. Remember, if you have any questions or any comments, put them down below. And don't forget to like and subscribe. Take care.